Hey guys, before we get started, I just want to give a big shout out to our new member, JS Cho, or JSCHO. I don't know how she wants us to pronounce it. Thank you so much for being a member at humanechoes.com. If you'd like to be a member and get access to awesome stuff like bonus podcasts, stickers, t-shirts, and even pins, sign up today at humanechoes.com. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Human Echoes podcast.
I'm Tony Southcott.
I'm going to do the intro, Tony. I'm going to do the whole intro, and I think how we're going to do it.
You're talking about 195 days or 195 weeks of not doing it this way. I'm sorry.
I'm Albert Berg.
I'm Tony
Southcott. And this is the show where we review oddball movies, have oddball discussions, and occasionally take questions from you. The oddball fans. Yes, we have a new intro that we're saying. We're going to say it every week. We might screw it up occasionally, Tony. But we are going to tell people what the podcast is at the top of the podcast. That feels like a good service to provide for people who might not have listened before, and they should be listening, because today the oddball movie we'll be talking about is a movie called Hong Kil Dong.
Do you think it should be Podball?
No. No, it shouldn't. That's terrible. Are you serious?
I think it's better than what you wrote, Podball.
No, we could. There's already an oddcast.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
That we fit oddcast like more than they do. I listened to it once. They're not that odd.
Are they not?
Not really.
Well, we are odd, and we are reviewing a very odd movie today. This is our first foray into the martial arts genre, Tony.
Yeah, we've talked a fair amount about Ip Man. We've talked a lot about just several different martial arts movies. Even like the Matrix movies could be considered like a kung fu type movie, but we've never really reviewed one.
And this is, I mean, you could say the Matrix, yeah, but this is the sort of the core, right? At least this is what I imagine when I think of a Wuxia film. It's a little bit rough around the edges. It's not really grounded in reality. They are in their own sort of magical past of Korea. Where they can fly and fight, and there is actual magic, sort of, that the ninjas and the martial arts people can use.
Yeah, some crazy gravity anomalies, like all sorts of stuff.
This is a whole, I mean, especially for, you know, the that part of the world, this is a whole genre of films that we've never really touched on, and we've picked an odd one to touch on. I'm not actually going to tell you why it's odd until after we've discussed the movie itself. Tony, don't say anything. We're gonna keep it on the down low. If you don't know what this movie is, we're just going to discuss the movie itself, but then we'll tell you why it's really out there and really off kilter. This is a movie about a guy who's named Hong Kil Dong. He lives in feudal Korea, ancient Korea, which Korea has been its own nation state for several thousand years before Japan invaded and did all their thing, and now we have North and South Korea. And he's living back in the bad old days. He is the son of a lord, but he's an illegitimate son. He's the son by his concubine, right?
It's not even his concubine, it's the maid. The guy's wife was saying that it would have at least been respectable if he had a concubine instead of the help. She really did not like the maid.
I thought that was a really good sort of motivation and character thing that came out of this movie, is that the wife, you can understand why she's mad at her husband just on a sort of human level. It's like, first of all, you cheated on me. Secondly, you had a son with the woman you cheated on me with. The woman you cheated on me with wasn't even of any kind of high birth. She wasn't even a professional person to be cheated on with. And now you want to legitimize his son and keep him in the household? No, you do not. He leaves. They leave. Go away. And so she sends him away. She makes him send him off to some other province. And along the way, they're waylaid by bandits, and they meet her father, I think, is the setup there.
I wasn't sure if he was actually her father, because they call a lot of people that aren't relation, like aunt and uncle and things like that. It seemed like it was her father, but I wasn't 100% set on that. But while they're being besieged by these just kind of ruffians on the road, like, they see him fly in, and he starts doing those, like, palm techniques that paralyze people.
And he takes them in under his wing and teaches the little boy, Hong Kil Dong, how to do the ninja martial arts stuff, which is maybe they do a really great technique where he starts teaching him. You see him as a little kid learning a little bit of the stuff that he needs to learn. And then he goes to his granddad and says, "Hey, how do I jump around like you do?" And the granddad says, "Well, here are some weights. Try jumping over this tree." He straps weights to his legs, and, you know, as a little kid, he jumps over a tree. And then it cuts to the tree being a full-grown tree and him being, like, 20 years old and flying over that thing like some crazy... Again, I don't know exactly... It's not flying. It's sort of gliding and jumping at the same time somehow.
Most of the time, they do a pretty good job of making, like, a parabolic arc, too, so it's not fully gliding. There are some times where it's just like, I'm going to go 30 feet on a straight line, but... It is pretty awesome.
And so he decides to go back to his father's house. This sort of basically runs into the same thing there. He calls her a stepmother, I believe. And the other, like the legitimate son, calls the handmaid stepmom, even though they're not... Weird familial stuff that probably would make more sense to us, A, if they had better subtitles, and B, if we understood.
Yeah, there were a lot of funny little things with the subtitles on the YouTube video we watched. You can find this on YouTube, by the way. There's going to be a link in the description. And a lot of it's like, bro, I can't move, bro.
Which is a great image. I'm just thinking about these guys back in feudal Korea, like, calling each other bro. But... He goes back to his mom's house, and he's not accepted still. His real mom is, like, forced into more slavery than she had been before, and he decides that he's gonna go off and make a name for himself, and ends up becoming kind of this Robin Hood character.
Yeah, he starts out pretty small. He's just, like, hunting and helping people out with those sorts of things, dropping off a deer and all that. They get a lot of mileage out of this one deer that they had tied up. Like, they use it in, like, three different scenes. I felt kind of bad for it, but whatever. And you see him kind of encountering, eventually he encounters the same ruffians that tried to rob him on the road when he was a child.
And that was really interesting to me, because some of them he has to beat up, but the one guy, he lets go. The guy goes back to his evil ways. He says, if I ever catch you killing again, you know, I'm going to kill you. He comes across him again. He's still on the road robbing people. And the guy says, you know, realizes what he's done, realizes that this guy has made something of himself and is actually doing good for the people, and breaks down and has this moment where he's like, you know what? Yeah, I deserve to die. And Hong Kil Dong can't do it. He says, well, you know what? The man who you are is dead, and lets him live again, and that guy actually turns over a new leaf. There's a lot of really interesting character moments in this, like the fact that his brother, even though their mothers are at odds with each other, his brother really does love him and does care about him. And when but there's that moment where the mom, the official wife of the guy, sends the assassin to kill Hong Kil Dong, and he doesn't. He's like, I can't out this guy because it's my mom who paid for him to come and kill you. And, you know, mother's love is kind of a big deal.
Yeah, a lot of conflict between, like familial rights and pride and all that, and him trying to be loyal to his half-brother.
And so eventually Hong Kil Dong comes up against this invasion force that's coming in, this force of ninjas, who are the most stereotypical...
It is, like, the 80s. Like, they are the stereotype of the ninja. You could have put these guys on the Ninja Turtles set. You could have used them in the most recent season of Daredevil. They are just the straight-up ninja type.
And, of course, Hong Kil Dong is dressed all in white and even has, like, a purple scarf, which I thought was interesting.
He kind of looks like a ninja version of Buzz Lightyear.
He does! You're right! Hong Kil Dong of Star Command. He takes on these ninjas, and the final climactic battle is one of the most... It's very innovative to me, partly because, like, the stuff between him and the one-on-one stuff with Hong Kil Dong, that was... I didn't expect him to get hurt as bad as he did. He gets hit with several throwing stars, and you're like, oh, wow.
Yeah, that would really suck.
It felt like a real moment in the movie where, like, is he going to be okay? Because he hasn't even gotten into the fight yet. Like, he's just getting there, and the guy just, like...
Especially because he hadn't really even been hit that much the entire movie up to that point.
Right, he's been dominating this whole time. He has the skills with which to pay the bills. And we've seen these ninjas be pretty skilled as well. He talks about how they have the magic that his grandfather taught him and nobody else in the country does. So he kind of figures out, okay, they're an invading force.
Yeah, like they've already stolen all the palace's gold, like all sorts of other things. And we've kind of glossed over this giant thing, which is the love interest plot. It's pretty standard for a kung fu movie, but it makes sense that a highborn girl can't be married to a lowborn man, even if he is like half highborn.
You're right. I complete like thinking about all the kung fu ninja stuff. I completely forgot that there was this dumb romance, which is important to the plot. Unfortunately, he does save her life back when he's with his grandfather on the mountain. And then when he goes back, she's like, oh, Hong Kil Dong, I like him. But then they find out that he's not eligible for her. And that's the whole impetus for him going off to make his name.
Yeah, they decide that after they're already set to be married and they find out that he's like son of a maid.
You'd think that they would do their research a little bit better.
Then again, the other guy's just trying to like pawn off that son to curry favor with the other families and everything too. So I could see him trying to hide that.
Yeah, and that character, the father character, is interesting too, because I think he cares a little bit about Hong Kil Dong and maybe cares about the handmaid and probably cares about his wife, but he also cares about himself. And so you have this really sort of layered guy trying to make his way in the court because he's a high ranking official, but also make good deals for his kids and try to help everybody be happy. It's not a good time for him. Maybe shouldn't have had sex with his handmaid.
He was a much better person than his wife was, despite the infidelity. If your wife's the type that's going to literally hire assassins to kill your son, maybe you could understand why he would cheat a little bit. She sounds frosty.
That's possible. Maybe he'd had enough of her hijinks. She's like, I know she cuts you off in traffic, but you can't hire the hitman to go kill her, okay? You gotta chill. I'm gonna go hang out with the handmaiden for no specific reason now.
I mean, it would be really hard in those days to cheat, too, because, I mean, you're talking about paper walls.
That is something that is very present in this movie, where everybody's having meetings in walls with walls made of paper, which, granted, we kind of have that too, right? Like, I could punch my fist through the wall behind me here and without too much difficulty. Walls are generally, especially interior walls, are not meant to keep people out.
Yeah, but still, like, you could just, like, passively hear them from across the entire place.
Yes, probably. Yeah, you had to keep it on the down low. We covered that. I did want to get the interesting thing. The one thing in this movie that I'd never seen before, Tony, and I don't know if it's common in this type of movie or if it's unique, but you had the army fighting against the ninjas, and I've never seen a force of good guys fighting against the force of bad guys where the good guys outnumber the bad guys by a lot
and are completely, absolutely inept.
I don't know about inept. I mean, they're compared to the ninjas who can fly and make themselves disappear. Yes, but they do come prepared. I mean, they're not
like by the end of the movie, they look like they know what they're doing. But in the first few encounters, like, they're literally hitting each other.
Well, I'm talking about that final battle on the beach, though.
Yeah, the final battle on the beach, they actually get their stuff together a little bit. They have, like, these really cool traps that they spring to trap people, or trap ninjas. It doesn't always work, but it's still, like, some foresight, some strategy. And but in the other scenes, they're, like, literally trying to chase him down a tree. And it's just a bunch of guys that don't know what they're doing, like, huddled around a tree, slowly trying to climb to find a guy that can obviously fly from tree to tree.
Well, that was when they were working for the bad guy, though. Like, the snotty, like, one of the guys that Hong Kil Dong eventually ends up stealing from to give his white rice to the poor.
Yeah, snow white rice.
That's obviously a idea of status, is having white rice back in that time. The poor people couldn't afford it. And he takes it away from the rich guys. But that, like, it's even that with that, there's a great ebb and flow to that battle, because you do see that moment, like, they have that cage trap, right? Where they get the ninjas all together in one place and they put those cage walls up, and you're like, all right, that was pretty smart. And then the ninjas just jump right over them. And it does this great sort of balancing act until that final moment where the ninjas are under the sand. And I thought that was really brilliant. Even like how that, you know, them seeing the ninjas moving and stabbing and the blood spurts out everywhere. That was just...
It was like striking oil, but ninja blood.
Well, and they did it different too. Like, the one guy they just stabbed and the blood just squirted out of the sand, right? And then like some other guys they stabbed and you would see the ninja like try to come up for air. and not be okay.
Or like the one that snuck off into the water and then tries to get on a boat, and like hidden soldiers just cut him down.
So I thought that that final battle, especially, and also the one-on-one stuff with Hong Kil Dong, as I mentioned earlier, he gets hurt early on and is really like, he's messed up from that, trying to sort of pull it together and manages to defeat the other guy, but it's not a sure thing. And it's only because his, you know, the love interest comes in and distracts the ninja for half a second and he's able to throw the sword at him.
Yeah. And that was, it was a little bit weird how they brought that big bad into it. Cause they had like the bad ninja, like the head of those ninjas, and he was in it for just a tiny bit. And then they brought in like the bigger, badder ninja, the leader of them all. They never like built him up or anything. You just knew he was badass because he had a different headband.
You got to have those visual signifiers, Tony. It is film. And he was pretty brutal in the cave as well.
Yeah, he's killing his own people for like lying just a little bit. He's like, we killed them all. It's like, no, you killed all but one. And that's enough for me to kill you.
Well, that one guy did turn out to be kind of a big deal, though. Which, yeah. And it was the guy that from earlier that Hong Kil Dong let live, which that was a moment where I was like, is he going to make it? Like, I was genuinely scared. There's so many great... This is not a great movie. I don't want to oversell it, but there are many, many wonderful moments in this film. But if you like that sort of old style action sword fighting type of movie, this has as good of anything that you're going to find in that. And it really works on a lot of levels. And then, you know, he gets through, he defeats everybody, right? He gets all the people taken care of. He defeats the big bad guy. You know, finally gets his act back together. He goes to the emperor. The emperor says, I'll give you anything. And he says, hey, can I marry this girl? And the emperor's like, well, wait a minute. When I said anything...
That's the only thing I cannot do.
Because he can't break the walls of society, right? Like, they still aren't willing to break down the walls between the rich and the poor. And so Hong Kil Dong sails off into the sunset to find a better land for his people. And that's the end of the movie. It's kind of bittersweet, honestly. Especially when you know about how this movie was made.
Yeah. Do you want to open it up with that?
I will tell... Okay, so you've heard us discuss this movie. You've heard us talk about...
Robin Hood, the differences between the rich and the poor, the class system.
This movie was made by Kim Jong-il... in North Korea in 1986.
So basically, straight up middle of the Cold War, Kim Jong-il state-sponsored kung fu film.
Not only was it made by Kim Jong-il in North Korea, but to make this film and several other films, Kim Jong-il kidnaps this South Korean director named Shin Sang-ok and his wife and brings them to North Korea. Shin Sang-ok is forced to stay in a concentration camp type prison for 3 years until he finally agrees to make these movies for Kim Jong-il. And he makes 5 movies for North Korea. And the interesting thing I'm reading, there's a book about this whole shenanigan called A Kim Jong-il Production. And I started reading this after I saw the movie. It's fascinating. This guy, Shin Sang-ok, he was a voracious filmmaker. He loved to make films, Tony. He made probably 4 or 5 a year, and they were all like really highly acclaimed in South Korea at the time. His wife was almost always his leading lady. He did all kinds of genres of film. He did drama, he did action, he did, you know, historical pieces, and he just cranked out as much as he could. And he was like the South Korean filmmaker. He gets kidnapped by the future dictator. They're sort of in a weird transitionary state at this point in North Korea's history, where
had Kim Il-sung died yet, or was that just happening?
He was getting older and they were getting ready to, they started calling Kim Jong-il dear leader, but he was not the like official in charge guy yet, but he was in charge of the media in North Korea. And the North Koreans, he was seeing what they were making. You know, he wanted to represent North Korea as a great nation and also to make a name for himself. It was very important. He was working some machinations. Very fascinating to read about him, like deferring to his father and acting like he didn't want power, but also doing things to get the other people who might be a challenge to him out of power subvertly. And he loved cinema. Kim Jong-il.
He had the biggest 35mm film collection in the world, didn't he?
I think so. And most of it was pirated because obviously it was North Korea. There wasn't a lot of, you know, nope, they're not just going to go and say to Paramount or, you know, Universal and be like, hey, you guys want to send us some films? So what they would, every single embassy that North Korea had would borrow film prints from theaters, and he sent film copying hardware to every single film embassy, or I'm sorry, regular embassy that North Korea had.
Lots of film embassies guys, out there.
I'm going to the film embassy today to see Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Haven't seen it yet, by the way, the new one.
I have not either. I'm not super interested. I might Redbox it.
I kind of want to, especially because my buddy Brantley's going to see it. We're getting off topic, though. We're talking about Kim Jong-il. He gets all these people who are, by law, not allowed to watch these movies to copy hundreds and thousands of films, and he just shuts himself away in his house and watches movie after movie after movie, and because of this, he knows what Western storytelling is. He understands what works and what doesn't. He kind of has that weird Quentin Tarantino thing where he's like, I didn't go to film school, I went to films.
What's also interesting is he was a huge James Bond fan, which I wonder if it ever dawned on him that he was just the bad guy in one of those.
I don't know. That's a whole... Again, I don't want to reference the book too much, and I haven't finished reading it yet, but reading about Kim Jong-il, yes, you have... I mean, obviously there's the cardboard cutout dictator persona that everybody knows, but behind all of those people is a real human person, and it talks about his relationship with his mom and sort of how those things shaped him, and I don't know what kind of person is that grows up in the lap of luxury in a country where obviously everything sucks.
Where during this time period, 20 million, or not 20, I think it's like 5 million people starved to death.
And yet he's still a person somewhere under there. Like there's still a guy who kind of loves his mom and, you know, kind of wants to please his dad, but his dad's never around. And the book even talks about how watching these American films helped him craft his own persona, right? Like there are the official state-sponsored biography of Kim Jong-il is this web of lies, but it's very like he's doing legend building. He's not just saying like, I'm the best. I came out and I punched a guy right out of my mother's womb. But I mean, he does talk about
he
that.
He does kind of Chuck Norris some things like him playing golf. He hit an 18 out of 18, something like that. Just bizarre stuff.
But he plays all of the, like, on all the symbolism, all of the stuff that's important to the North Koreans. And the other thing the book goes into, which I'd never considered all of the pieces of Korea's history together from their point of view. I knew about the Korean War. I kind of knew about the Japanese invasion of Korea. But to think about it from their perspective, in the span of about 50 years, everything turned to crap for them. Because for over 1,000 years, Korea had been one nation, independent, their own thing. Japan gets a little big for their britches and decides, we want to get some more stuff. Goes to Korea because it's a, you know, a staging ground into Russia and China. Takes over, like, hammers giant metal spikes into their holy hills to figuratively, and I guess literally if you're Korean, kill the spirit of the nation. And then after Japan loses the war, they're the battleground between the United States and Russia, and they get carved in half just completely arbitrarily because of two other giant nations' politics. It not a great time to be Korean.
No. Like now you still see like that, like the wake of that. It's just so dramatic, the differences that are still happening. I saw a really weird picture from North Korea a couple days ago where the roller coasters weren't working. So you just had hundreds of people walking up and down roller coasters.
Wait, what?
Yeah. Like it's just this old roller coaster. And because the carts don't work, people are just like having fun by walking up and down roller coaster tracks. Like there's literally just hundreds of people hanging on these tracks.
I gotta say, if I was in an abandoned or a non-working roller coaster and nobody stopped me, I would totally climb up the roller coaster too.
Yeah.
So, I guess I can't fault them for that, but...
It's just an odd picture.
So, anyway, you have this country that is trying to present not only an image of a leader, but an image of itself as modern and functioning. And so Kim Jong-il wants to make these movies, wants to sort of compete with these movies that he's been watching. And he, you know, he puts his plan into motion. And I gotta say, Tony, while I don't think that these films got a lot of traction in sort of what he would have liked to see or the, with the Western world, I'm going to read the guy's name again because I've forgotten it. Shin Sang-ok did a really good job. And it's fascinating to think about this guy who loves to make films, right? That's what he just wants to do all the time. Gets sent to what used to be part of his country
and is now at war with his
current country, plunged into a nightmare, and then forced to do the thing that he really wants to do anyway with the woman he loves to do it with. And I'm not talking about sex. I'm talking about making movies, and his wife was an actress. It's this... I don't know. Like, of the movies that I want to see made, this is one of them, Tony. Like, this is one of those, how did it get made, sort of like the Disaster Artists. If we could get... And, like, as I mentioned before, the book is called A Kim Jong-il Production. If you could get a movie of that, of this guy and his hardships, but then also making art within the hardship, and Kim Jong-il kind of also making art at the same time, because... Again, even though he's like a huge bastard in this story, he's also like, I've got some ideas and we're going to do great things. And what do you need, Mr. Director? Now that you're on our crew, we will do whatever. You need someone to die in this stunt? That's okay. They're expendable.
Yeah, there were a lot of people that were actually getting beat up in this too. Like, you could tell people weren't pulling their punches entirely.
The article that originally put me onto this even talked about how that there was a scene in one of these movies where they needed to blow up a train. And Kim Jong-il just said, all right, well, we'll blow up a train. Like, full scale. The train, not in this movie, unfortunately. I was hoping, that, you know, it's not the right time period. But he gave him all of the creative freedom he could have possibly wanted and none of the actual freedom. And eventually, the director and his wife did escape. They made a Godzilla knockoff, which the name of it escapes me. It's not really a, like... It was just a giant monster movie, set in sort of feudal Korea, where this guy builds this little golem and it gets giant and, you know, goes stomping around and has to be fought. And they were so well, you know, the accolades for the film were so great, especially in places like France, that and because they played the part of the dutiful North Koreans doing the thing, that they managed to, like, get flown out there for the premiere and escape from the North Koreans. So there's even a kind of happy ending to the story.
That's awesome. I would really like to see that movie. Like, that would be one that would fascinate me. I don't know if they have one yet, like if South Korea or anyone else has made one. I would watch that in a second.
Well, again, it's not my book. I feel like I've shilled for it a little bit, but the book is called A Kim Jong-il Production, and I have enjoyed every bit of it so far. I'm not finished. You know, I'm probably 20% through, but really highly recommend that book and watching these movies. I'm going to go back and I think try to go through this guy's filmography, because especially the North Korean stuff, I'd like to see what it is that he makes. And it's, is it just me, or is the message of this movie completely diametrically opposed to everything that the North Koreans actually are?
That was a lot of what I was thinking at the time. Like, somehow they ended up making their Mao's dynasty into a haves and have nots. And It just seems to happen with that whole, like, Soviet-style communism.
Well, right, you have your hero of the movie stealing from the rich who are hoarding all the good stuff for themselves, and the people are starving in the streets and literally don't have food, while the rich people have everything. And that is how it is, right? That's actually how it is in North Korea. The government are those people that the hero is stealing from. How do you make this movie unironically? I don't understand.
I wouldn't be surprised if he was that with a very deft hand. He did this on, like, very intentionally for that, because I mean, he was in a concentration camp there for 3 years, and their concentration camps are insane. Like, you literally have kids beating each other over getting to eat a mouse.
I don't even like to think about that, but yeah,
it's messed up. It's crazy. I like, the only reason I even noticed this, I just saw it was a Korean thing. It didn't say North Korea. They just said Korea. So I was like, oh, cool. I like Korean movies. And then I noticed the channel name was like North Korean Films. I didn't actually know it was North Korean until after I'd finished it.
Well, that's just what I wanted, because I went into this knowing it was North Korean. And I wanted to hear your perspective, sort of not knowing about it ahead of time. just because I don't know if that affects... I mean, when I got to the end of the movie and they go off to find the better land, right? And I think symbolically from the North Korean standpoint, that's them like, hey, we're going to turn off all this class system stuff and we're going to be communists and it's going to be great and everybody's going to be equal. But they don't find the better... The real life is that they don't find that better land, that they just end up recreating it. And it's so... It's just so tragic and sad. It left me with, I mean, already the end of the movie's kind of bittersweet, and then you sort of realize the circumstances under which it was made, and it just hits you in the gut. Like, they wanted the idea that these people wanted to make something better, right? Like that there was an ideal of communism that they didn't start out, I don't think, to be dictators and be wealthy and have all the stuff. But at some point, it turned into that, and they lost... I don't know. Maybe I'm humanizing the bad guys too much, Tony. But it's a weird place to be.
It definitely is. And it's just made that much more fascinating. Because if you were to just watch this and you didn't know any of the history behind it, it turns into a pretty standard kung fu movie. There's a few things that happen in kung fu movies. Either the master is killed, the main guy falls in love... Or there's like a very, very, very clear like shogun or dictator that needs to be taken out. Those are the three main plot lines of almost any kung fu movie. And like this one took a lot of that formula. It didn't have the crispest martial arts I've seen in any of these movies. Like it's not as disciplined as you would see in like an old Japanese or Chinese movie. Like it still captures a lot of really fun moments. It just doesn't have like clearly cut styles. And like the bad guys aren't. Like, it's not a big setup getting to the end, so it's not perfect as far as, like, one of these movies goes, but it's still a lot of fun to watch. It's a 30-year-old movie, and it's hard for me to watch a lot of those just because they look crappy. The only thing I've really hated about this movie, the only thing at all, is I hate the sound effects from old kung fu movies. It's like, not every punch sounds exactly the same. Not every sword swing makes a giant whoosh. Like, it's okay just to, like, let silence happen on film sometimes.
Well, style of the time and everything, I know. Tony.
It's, like, that's a nitpick. It's not something that ruined the movie. It's just something that I've never liked.
One of the things that bothered me was just it felt a little bit slow in a lot of places. I enjoyed the kung fu so much that I was like, all right, people are talking. Let's get back to the fights, you guys.
It's not quite, the raid like that where you get, like, a little bit of time to catch your breath and then it ramps up again.
And it's fine. Like I said, the characters are good and everything, but that wasn't really what I came for. Once I saw the kung fu fighting happen, I wanted everybody to be kung fu fighting all the time. And that didn't happen. So, yeah.
I think on that channel where this one is, there's five of these films on there. I don't know if that's all from the same director or if it's just a few others.
Well, I think I'll be going back to check some of them out. I don't know that we'll be reviewing them. But I also, as a follow-up to last week, we talked about, I was going to say Gore Vidal.
Gore Verbinski.
Gore Verbinski. I went back and started watching his Lone Ranger, which I know was critically panned. I haven't finished it yet, but while I don't love the Army Hammer Lone Ranger character, everything else about that movie I'm really enjoying. And I think I might just have sort of a little soft spot for Gore Verbinski.
Yeah, I actually thought about going to see that movie, but I saw how panned it was, and I was just like, I don't want to spend $7 or $8 on it right now. I just never got back to it. Is it on Netflix or anything right now?
No, I kept looking and looking and looking, and eventually I bit the bullet and rented it for $3 on Amazon. But it's Pirates of the Caribbean in the West. It's Cowboys of the Caribbean, but in... Not in the Caribbean. And Johnny Depp is essentially Captain Jack Sparrow, and the Lone Ranger Army Hammer character is sort of Will Turner. You know, he's sort of the upstanding, do-right kind of guy. Very much so like Dudley Do-Right. But it's a supernatural-ish, like, over-stylized, if you're not into that, then I can understand why you wouldn't be. But after having just said in the past podcast how much I really enjoy Gore Verbinski's art direction and production design in all of his movies, there's a lot of really cool art direction and production design in The Lone Ranger, and I'm digging on that a lot. Did we get viewer questions this week, Tony?
We did. We got them from a few different sources, not all of them on Twitter, so I'm going to start with my friend George, And he says, what evidence do we have that reality is not homogeneous amongst all organisms?
Now, could you explain what George is talking about here? Because it sounds like he's high, and he might not have composed that text exactly
in a clear manner. I know that he works the night shift, so he might have woken up to my text message and just, like, put whatever he was thinking about. But I'm thinking that he's talking about how some creatures just seem to exist in an entirely different set of reality than we do. Like, the first example that comes to mind is my cat. Like, as far as the way things go, my cat just sees shit that is not there. Like, flat out. It'll be 3 a.m, he'll run in circles, just making crazy noises, then run up to a wall, sit down, and stare for 2 hours, just at a spot on the wall. Like, he's seeing something clearly that I'm not. Or if you look at, like, mantis shrimp that see in trillions more colors than we do, because they've got, like, 16 different sets of rods and cones instead of R3. Like, they perceive the world entirely differently. They could, like, there's theories that they can actually see cancer cells and things like that. It's really weird.
So you're saying that the idea here is that our perception affects our reality?
Yes.
Not literally, not like if I'm blind, that there's no light in the world. But for me, there's no light in the world. So if I'm a blind person, I have a different format and framework for reality. Yeah. And if I can see things and incorporate that into my mind.
And mathematically, you're going to have the same, like, framework. Like, in the end, it's all physics. But as far as your perception of it, like, that can drastically change. Like, I'm sure you've met people where it's like, they're not thinking on the same level or on the same, like, planet that we are.
I meet people every day that aren't thinking on my level, Tony. I'm thinking on a pretty high level. I don't know if y'all knew that. Smart guy right here.
Humble, too.
But yeah, we kind of discussed this idea on the podcast before. You know, it definitely your experience changes how you feel about reality. I don't think it actually changes reality, though, Tony. I'm pretty sure that the physics of the universe... I kind of, when I heard this question initially, I thought he was talking about, like, is it all a hologram? Are we in some kind of simulation, man?
And if he would have been more awake, he might have actually put that in there. Like, it might have been like, are we living in, like, is this the Matrix? Are we, like, how many times deep are we in the Matrix? Do we keep recreating things, going smaller and smaller and smaller?
I'm pretty sure that I'm living in a simulation right now.
There are times where I definitely feel that.
If you don't believe it, I need you to go on YouTube and search the words monster trucks movie trailer and watch that and tell me that was not made specifically for me personally, because that is all the proof that I need that this is my universe, that it revolves around me. Like, they made that movie, Tony. It has to be for me.
It's like every once in a while, just the stars align up for Berg. We're in Berg's universe.
See, the thing about the monster trucks movie, Tony, that you see in the trailer is that Monster Trucks the movie is about trucks that are also monsters and have monsters inside of them. And so it's literal monster trucks. They're trucks that are monsters.
So it's like Cars but with monsters.
Well, so the monsters inhabit the shell of the truck. The truck already exists. It's already been made. But the monsters just happen to really like living inside of the trucks and being their engines. And they have big tentacle things that can reach out and grab other trucks. Awesome. 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 I don't care that it's being released in January. Me and AJ are going to go see that movie.
Is it animated or live action?
No, it's live action.
That's that movie. Like, you've mentioned it like 6 times, and I just can't bring myself to watch the trailer.
It's like 2 minutes of pure joy. It does, like, some of the acting, even in the trailer, looks really bad. It looks bad. But the special effects look good, and it looks like a dumb, fun story, and I want to see it. I want to see it, Tony. I want to see it so bad.
Next question comes from my brother, @Jason_ThorCarry on Twitter. Or he's also a lot more active on Facebook and has like 3,000 friends there, so you can find him under Jason Carey. But if you and Al woke up one day and had switched bodies, how would you spend the rest of the week living as each other?
Oh, wow, that's a good one. And you'd have to put up with my kids and my wife.
I would just, I'd leave.
You would just leave? You'd just go somewhere else?
I'd be like, well, I'm going to make sure that, like, this body actually knows what it's like to get drunk, and like I'd run without it being all painful in my spine and hips, and I would do all sorts of things like that for a little while, and I would just be gone.
Like, you wouldn't run. See, the thing is, okay, the muscles are not developed correctly for you to run the right way. You would just be tired. I know this because I have done. Right now, I'm trying to update my running style, right? Because I'm a complete nerd or something, and I saw a video on Reddit about, like, here's how you should be running. And I was like, oh, wow. I'm running, like, clomp, 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 clomp. And apparently I'm supposed to be running, like, woo, 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 woo.
That's how I run. I'm like a graceful
little audio flower. For you, audio listeners there, sort of described it.
I run like the movie we watched. I sail.
Well, I do not, and I've been trying to. I was like, all right, well, I'm going to kick my legs more. I'm going to sort of, like, have a more full stride instead of the pa-thump, 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 pa-thump thing. And it wears me out because I'm not used to using those muscles that way. So now I'm, like, I used to be able to run, like, my whole three-mile thing and be like, all right, yeah, I got to the end. And now I'm like, stop, like, half a mile in because I'm using different muscles. And I have faith that it will be advantageous in the long run, but right now it sucks. Sucks majorly.
I think I could handle that, to just experience what it's like to not have lower back pain all the time.
I mean, that would be great. I guess I would just like
the full direction. That would be cool.
I would just be in pain a lot. I don't. That's something I think about many times when I think about, like, going into somebody else's body, or like my wife's body, where she has to deal with diabetes, and also her foot also runs into things all the time. I don't know what that is. Like, always she's hurting her feet. I don't understand. I haven't kicked something and hurt my foot in a year, but she's kicked it like three times in the last week and almost broke a toe.
I got the weirdest injury I think I've ever gotten yesterday. Like, it's not a very big injury, but I was like, I was cleaning a pan and some cheese had like congealed into nastiness on there. So I was using my thumbnail to like pick it off, and I slipped. And this cheese spike went under my fingernail really deep and got stuck.
I feel your pain.
It was,
I feel it in my fingers.
It was so gross. Oh. And I'm just like, oh, I hope it doesn't put like some gross bacterial infection under the nail. But like, it's still at the point where like you can see where the spike went under the nail because it's slightly disconnected the skin.
Yep. Okay. I'm with you. I'm still here.
So odd injuries happen sometimes, stupid cheese.
I have done that myself, by the way. I don't know if in that exact scenario, although I know I can imagine like precisely what you're talking about, because I have lots of cast iron pans. Sometimes stuff gets stuck to them. I soak them for a little bit. Maybe I should soak them for longer, but I'm anxious to get them clean, and you just... digging with your fingernails is not great. It's not a great
time.
You're
just like, you figure, oh, it'll pop off real quick, and you're like, that's a little bit stuck, so you press harder and your hand slips.
Next question.
Lindsay at GeekGirlCo on Twitter asks us, flat or Phillips?
Well, that's kind of a situational answer, right? Yeah. I don't think there's a one size fits, like, literally there is not a one size fits all answer for that.
I mean, if you're lucky, you can sometimes use a flat on a Phillips if it's got like just enough space. But otherwise, that really is situational.
Well, they make those dual Phillip and flat screws, though, right?
Yeah. The last time I bought screws, I accidentally bought hex screws without even noticing. I was just like, all right, I need something to drill into my desk so I can set up this microphone, actually. And I thought it was like, okay, this will work. I didn't look, and it was like the hex style one. So I had to use like, I had to like pre-drill and use this hand tool I have. That's like an Allen wrench, basically. It sucks so much more than use my damn drill. So both of
you
those
still should
over
pre-drill,
hex.
Tony. Like, that's, you're going to split the wood otherwise.
Yeah. But it's like a $9 thing I bought off of Amazon. So I didn't care that much.
Okay. Well, but the interesting thing is when I'm presented with one of the dual option screws, I think first I will reach for that Phillips head screwdriver. But the problem is, Tony, the Phillips head screwdriver, if it's really tight in there, will strip that right open.
Yep.
Unless it's a real thick screw. And what you do get from the flathead is you get that extra torque power that isn't going to strip the screw out, but it doesn't stay put. When they make the flathead screws, they don't put ends on it, so the thing will slip off the end. Put in a thing on the end so it doesn't slip out, is all I'm saying.
Yeah, but then you'd have so many times where like your flathead is just a little too big and won't work at all.
I have that problem many times, Tony. I mean, what? No.
At least
sex.
At least whenever you're talking about a flathead, you can use a butter knife if everything else fails.
Yeah, or your pocket knife or something like that. There are many applications where the flathead is best. The real answer is the star-headed screws are the best, but nobody has that screwdriver.
Yeah.
Those things, they won't slip. They won't strip out unless you're like dealing with some major stuff, and nobody will use them. Like, they're a specialty tool, but holy crap, do those things work.
Yeah.
And like gangbusters.
The weirdest one that I've worked with are the tri-heads that you see on Apple computers, where you have to buy a specifically shaped screwdriver from Apple. And I'm sure they've got knockoffs now, but this was whenever the new models came out for like the MacBook Air. And you're having to do these tri-heads, and there is no way around it. Like, I could not find any way other than using this specific one.
I had that when I took apart my cell phone back in the day as well. I broke the screen and I ordered a replacement, and it came with its own little tri-head screwdriver to take the screws out. And it didn't work either. But talk about, man... It's a complicated piece of equipment, a cell phone is. Turns out to be.
Yeah, they're kind of fun to work on, though.
You can have the fun. You can have all of the fun. I don't want any fun. I have zero fun. I want the fun is when I pick it up and it works, and I don't have to do anything. That's why I have this giant case, and I like pray every time I drop it and pick it up, because I'm like, please, I don't want to have to deal with a broken screen. I don't even think you can do it anymore. I think it is literally beyond the point where you can fix your own cell phone.
A lot of them have it so that the batteries are even soldered on, and now that's like a selling point for LG phones, that they have quick swap batteries.
By the way, we have a late breaking question from Mr. Chris Becker at Ultron 38. He said, when is Al going to man up and watch the classic Troll 2?
Probably in November, because that's been nominated before for Viewer's Choice Month. I've actually had that question 3 times from separate people this week through DMs and all sorts of different methods.
That Chris Brecker's very interested in that, by the way. He asked me personally, he's like, have you seen Troll 2? And I was like, not yet. But again, it's not one of those things I have anything against. I just haven't got around to it. I don't need to watch it.
Yeah, it's like Birdemic and everything. It's like someday we're going to end up watching it and it's going to be terrible and it could be amazing. But it's going to be, it'll happen when it happens.
Do we have another question?
If you could have tea with one director, past or current, and pick their brain about one film, theirs or another, whom and which?
You know, I just was on Twitter yesterday talking about Primer, and I would love to talk to Shane Carruth about my theory about Primer, which is not a theory. It's a confirmable fact if you watch the movie, but he denies it, and he's lying. He's lying about the fact that time travel doesn't occur earlier in the film than when we see. Not true.
Yeah, that's like one of the few things I did glean from that movie. It's like, otherwise it just doesn't make sense.
Well, it makes sense. Like, you can have the movie without time travel earlier. All right, you can. But when Abe wakes up and throws his shoe at the blinds, that is a post-time travel Abe that is zonked out from all the time traveling that he's doing. He has the tape. You hear him repeat to himself the line that he's about to say when he walks through the living room, because he has the tape of how the day is going to play out from himself when he went through the day before this. It's pretty crystal clear, and Aspergillus Ticor can't grow on an argon-rich environment. That's all I've got to say.
There you go.
Needs oxygen or, what is the other thing? Carbon dioxide. Definitely. But it's a plant. Dang it. Go read the Primer Universe blog, and it'll just like, that's like a whole big giant quicksand hole of, like, it's this dude basically wrote an entire book explaining Primer, and he thought a lot about it. And man, will that get your gears going if you like Primer?
I've seen so many different charts of things that are happening in Primer as far as like when events are happening. And it's like, man, people got so into this. Probably the most talked about $9,000 movie ever.
And one of the things that I never understood, the Granger incident. You know what? This is impossibly nerdy. I'm not even going to. I was about to start talking about the Granger incident and why it happened and like the kickoff for it. And nobody cares. No, like 5 people in the audience, if that, are going to be like, oh, I want to hear about the Granger incident.
Just talk to Al on Twitter about it, @Albert_Berg. He'll enlighten you.
I will say this. I didn't realize that what they were doing that morning was to actually go and enact their plan to punch their boss in the face and then go back in time. Didn't understand that. I don't know if that's the movie's fault or just me being dumb, but I've watched that movie like 10 times and I never picked up like where they're saying like, oh yeah, let's go do that thing we talked about. But apparently that's what's happening. And then the Granger incident happens, and something goes wrong in that timeline, and he has to come back to fix it, but he isn't properly prepared, and he ends up messed up, and maybe Aaron hurts him and, like, knocks him out because he knows that Granger will tell him things about the future. Wow, does that movie get really confusing, is all I'm going to say. There are so many things, rabbit holes, that you can go down. What a good movie.
Next question from Dr. John Jones at DVWet on Twitter. The new A&W root beer Pop-Tarts, yes or no? If yes, toasted or non?
If you're eating Pop-Tarts without toasting them, you're just doing life wrong.
No, you gotta microwave them.
No.
And then, like, dip them in milk, like a donut.
That's what they're for. The pop is them popping out of the mic, of not the mic, well, whatever, you know, but popping out of something, hopefully your toaster. Why would you eat cold Pop-Tarts? I mean, unless you are... If you literally don't have those 3 minutes, okay? I can understand if you don't have a toaster with you, if you're, like, in the deserts of Iraq somewhere.
Yeah, but then all you have possibly to do is just set them out for, like, 3 or 4 minutes. Like, just put them on a surface and let them chill.
Maybe you're on the run from the law, Tony, and you, like, you know, maybe it's a post-apocalyptic wasteland where toasters don't exist. But other than that, there's no reason not to toast it, okay? Pop it down, make your coffee, take it and go if you're in that big of a hurry. It will be done pretty quickly, and it'll taste delicious. I know because I did it this morning.
I love Pop-Tarts. I haven't had a Pop-Tart in probably a year, but I love Pop-Tarts.
They taste so good hot.
Yeah.
And they get that, like, nice little just, like, browning on the outside.
Or you go, like, premium, get a toaster strudel.
Well, toaster strudels are just in a whole different level. Like, that's just, it's a different food.
Yeah.
Okay? And it's an amazing food. But it's still the same thing, right? You don't eat them frozen out of the box if you're a sane human being. You put them in the device which they were designed to be put in and use that device in the manner specified.
Man, a toaster strudel, like, not toasted is one of the more depressing thoughts I've ever had. Just biting into it and it's still being frozen in the center and you just suck on it. Just
sometimes they don't get toasted all the way in the toaster, and that is disappointing. Where you, like, go to bite and, like, the outside is toasted, but the inside doesn't get done.
It's just sad.
It is sad.
If you let it sit for a couple minutes, it'll be fine.
On the topic of the A&W thing, I'm okay with the flavor of root beer. I used to only like root beer. Like, when I would go to restaurants and, like, sort of, you know, it would be a big deal. Because we didn't actually have soda in our house hardly ever when I was growing up. So when I go to a restaurant and I would order pop, soda, whatever, it would always be root beer for a long time. It was like through my early to mid 20s, which led to inevitably every single time I went to a Chinese restaurant. I don't know what it was about Chinese restaurant, but every time I was in a Chinese restaurant, they would say, "What kind of soft drink do you want?" And I would say, like, "I'd like some root beer." And they'd say, "We'd have Dr. Pepper."
That's not even the same ballpark.
It's not exactly. It's like,
yes, it's brown.
I mean, they would have Pepsi, too, but they wouldn't offer me Pepsi. Somehow, like, in their minds, root beer and Dr. Pepper were essentially just the two different flavors of the same thing. I don't even know, like, it's not like root beer is just a Coke product or just a Pepsi product. Everybody can make root beer. It's not a trademark name. And, oh boy, let me talk to you guys about ginger beer in a minute. But root beer could just, they can have root beer. Have root beer, Chinese restaurants, is what I'm saying. And now, I'm going to tell you guys, everybody needs to start drinking ginger beer. Because that is where it's at, because it has ginger in it. It tastes good.
I don't know if I've ever actually had ginger. Like, I've seen it on my plates, like, at Asian food places, especially, like, sushi places, and I've been like, yeah, I'll skip it this time. Forever.
Oh, you're missing out! I usually get fresh ginger, and sometimes I'll put it in my fried rice and whatnot, but you get that ginger beer. I go to the local hardware store, and they have the old-timey glass bottles. They have an assortment there at the checkout that you can buy, because it's an awesome store. It has lots of cool stuff. And they have Cock and Bull ginger beer that you pick up. It's, like, in this red bottle, and it will, like, turn your... Like, I mean, it's not hot in the sense of, like, hot sauce, but there's just, like, a kick to that stuff.
That is good. That sounds so disgusting. No, sounds so gross. You're wrong. I don't, like, I've had, like, a sip of ginger ale, and I thought it was, like, the worst soda ever.
Well, ginger ale is different. I mean, it does have that ginger flavor, but ginger beer is, it has the bite to it. Ginger ale doesn't have as much of the bite, and this is more of a cola taste.
Hmm.
It's not, maybe cola is not the right word, but it's not like ginger ale at all. People need to check it out. It's not like a real beer, by the way. I don't know, I didn't know much about ginger beer, I sort of outside of seeing it referenced in Westerns. It's like that and sarsaparilla.
Yeah, I've always been curious about sarsaparilla, but I don't know what it is.
I think they're both non-alcoholic sort of flavored drinks. The version I drink is non-alcoholic, although it does have instructions for building a Moscow Mule with it. Not building, constructing, making, mixing.
Crafting?
Mixing is the word.
Mixing. You would be a mixologist. Alcohol. Yes, Al's teetotal.
But if you want a good flavored drink, try that cock and bull. Good stuff.
You heard it from Al. Try that cock.
It's a rooster.
Last question of the afternoon is, imagining archaeologists 5,000 years in the future discovering remnants of our current media, what would they conclude about us?
Well, I mean, they listen to us and they would conclude that the listeners of the Human Echoes podcast are amazing human beings who also have incredible hipster tendencies and, like, know about the cool stuff but don't tell their friends. And then our podcast doesn't spread and we got fired by Joe.
Oh.
And by fired, I mean he hired his scrap metal hired killers to come and get us. And we're no longer alive in the future.
This incarnation of me isn't. I'm pretty sure I could be like Eduardo something on like work for the scrapyard. We'll see what happens.
Oh yeah, you're gonna like transition over. And be like, well, the podcast thing didn't work out. Yeah, how about I haul some scrap for you?
They come over, like they come after me, and I'm like, I'll take out Al for you. Just let me live.
What if it all survives? What if they just have to sift through like huge heart archives of YouTube videos
and like the
and
the
it's
people
not
that
sorted.
Are, the people that are going through every tweet just trying to, like, glean information. Like, I hope it's just a robot that's, like, going through and sorting stuff.
They would have to watch that video of the guy that I saw the other day, like, the 30-year-old dude playing Yandere Simulator on YouTube, which was one of the most awkward things I've ever seen.
What's Yandere ever. Simulator? Is it, like, one of those dating sims?
Okay, so... Yeah, Yandere is like a stereotypical Japanese school where the girls all wear Catholic schoolgirl type outfits. If you're from America, kind of to give you, it's Japanese girls in Catholic schoolgirl outfits, and Yandere Simulator is those girls getting into what at first seem like sexual situations, but then turn out to be mostly innocent, but then kind of really aren't, which I'm fine with. If that's your thing, right? I understand people being into stuff. I mean, fine if you play the game, but watching a dude play this game without any irony, it just like, I'm imagining him like bald and 30 and in his underwear sitting there like recording this game where one of the gameplay mechanics is that you have to get upskirt shots of the other girl's panties with your cell phone and you're crawling around on the floor doing this. There's just nothing about that that I want to see. That was
reminds me of a sentence I once heard from a girl I used to date that she was playing one of those in her room, just laughing about it, just checking it out. And like her mom walks in, she's like, what are you doing? She's like, shut up, mom. I'm trying to sleep with all these girls.
Well, it was just such an odd situation because the guy was completely, he was like doing a tutorial, right? It's like, all right, here's what you do. You got to get like 5 upskirt shots here. And we're going to send him to this person over here and he's going to give us another quest. And then we overhear this girl and like you overhear the girl give this explanation of like talking about her dad, which obviously is supposed to lead you to believe that he's sexually abusing her. But then you find out later, oh, you completely misunderstood. He's just in a lot of debt. And oh, by the way, you have to take naughty pictures of yourself or the other girl, then you kidnap another girl. It was just like, it's suggestive, but not actually sexual things, the game. And again, I understand if you're into that. I'm not like bashing the idea of the game, but watching someone else play it in a completely unironic, just was.
There's a lot of Twitch streams of that right now.
Are you watching them right now?
No,
Tony?
I'm not watching
Tony,
them right now. I'm just
come
saying
back.
Like, you go through and like you'll find one of those games above like really good games. Like it'll be above Fallout 4.
I like if you're streaming it without talking, if you're just streaming the gameplay that people are living, but if you're just it was odd. It was a very odd situation. I didn't feel comfortable afterwards. I felt like I had sort of watched someone else's enjoyments of their fetish, but they were trying to cover it up as being regular, and it didn't. I don't know. It was a weird situation.
Anyway, I think that's going to be everything for the week.
Is that not enough? Is that not enough?
Al's discomfort is always a good thing to end on. We like dragging him to deep waters, even if he does it to himself sometimes. So what I'd like you guys to do is to go over to humanechoes.com. There's a lot of ways you can help us out and keep this podcast rolling. The number one way is by becoming a member. It gets you access to the bonus podcast. It gets you buttons. It gets you like stickers. All sorts of other stuff heads your way whenever you become a member, either $2, $5, $10, or $20. If you go to $20 a month, like we send you a shirt right away. You get lots of other cool benefits. If you go to the $5 level, you're getting postcards. Just a lot of really fun things on there. And the best product we make, which is the bonus podcast. We've got a few samples if you dig into the archives just a little bit. Next way you can help us is through the Amazon link on the right hand side of the page or at the bottom of a lot of our posts. If you click that, anything you buy at Amazon gets us a nice little cut. We got several $100 over the past couple months because people have been using it. Like, I know that some people are buying office supplies for their businesses. Some people are buying treadmills. There's a lot of cool stuff going on, and we thank you very, very much for doing that.
And next week, we will be covering another movie that we haven't actually talked about ahead of time, Tony.
Yeah, we forgot about that.
It'll be a movie. It probably will be.
Unless
it
we find like a book, but it's most likely going to be a movie.
We might review like an object, you know, like I have this, here's this coffee cup. Let's talk about this coffee cup next week, Tony.
I mean, the ridges on that thing, like the porcelain, it's perfect.
It's plastic and there are no ridges, but.
I can't see you.
You know, that's the objectiveness of art. That's how that works. Everybody sees that in their own light.
Science.
What coffee cup did you see? We'll discuss that next week or possibly a movie. Thanks so much for listening, guys.
Have a good one.
Have a great week.
Bye.
I want to hear somebody now with like that really thick Southern accent play Dwarf Fortress. All right, y'all. We're gonna get in here and like try to get us some lungfish today. The lungfish have really been active up there in the springtime, and they'll just come right into your tunnels and wreak havoc with all of your stuff. So we're gonna get us some lungfish. We're going to build a trap for it. Of course, now you need some workshops, and you wouldn't expect that the kitchen workshop would be in workshops. You'd think it'd be like a building or whatever, but no, it's a workshop, y'all.